Penguin Random House Audio presents The Saturday Night Ghost Club by Craig Davidson. Read for you by Corey Brill. The brain is wider than the sky, for put them side by side, the one the other will contain with ease, and you beside. The brain is deeper than the sea, for hold them, blue to blue, the one the other will absorb as sponges buckets do. The brain is just the weight of God, for heft them, pound for pound, and they will differ if they do, as syllable from sound. Emily Dickinson, 632. Memory is another word for story, and nothing is more unreliable. Anne Marie MacDonald, Fall on Your Knees. Chapter 1. Monsters. Most people believe the human brain is solid. They imagine a loaf of bread soaked in gelatin. You can hack off quivering slices, same as you would with a jello mold at a family picnic. But the truth is, the brain's texture is more like toothpaste. Brain matter will squeeze through a keyhole. In cases of severe cranial swelling, surgeons use a drill. I prefer the RA2, a Korean model, 30,000 RPM with silicone hand grips for comfort, to bore into the skull. If the swelling cannot be stopped, the living brain will project from the hole in an inverted funnel. This is called a coning, and it marks an end. Most people also believe the brain is gray. Its cells are called gray matter, after all, and isn't that how the organ looks in horror flicks? A slaty walnut floating in a jar of formaldehyde in some mad scientist's lab. But a sheathed brain is bracingly pink. The tissue only turns gray once the cerebrospinal sac has been perforated, once the air hits it. When a brain cones, the tissue changes color. Traceries of ash thread through that bubblegum pink as a million thoughts flicker and die. People think neurosurgeons cut into brains with a scalpel. Another myth. How can you carve toothpaste? An infant's brain matter is even less substantial than an adult's, like pancake batter. I operate with a sucker wand, a tool that is exactly as it sounds. As I investigate the runnels of a patient's brain, it grips me that something unforgivingly solid, my wand, is moving through something ephemeral, dreamlike, a patient's memories. Though I work carefully and with a keen knowledge of the cerebral topography, my wand remains a beast blundering through fields of budding shoots. If I trample something critical, the patient may awaken lacking a vital memory. That one where they gazed into the sky as a child, wondering how a star might taste, settling on breathtaking wintergreen. The smell of their newborn daughter's scalp, or that haunting tingle on their lips following their first kiss. I navigate the storerooms of a patient's consciousness, passing memories in their golden vaults, my wand clumsily bayoneting, it often seems, the pink jelly that holds everything the patient is or will ever be. Hard as I try not to disturb the furniture, things happen. I'm forced to accept these tragic outcomes for the same reason that the patients on my table must accept their own lot. We are only human, a condition of perpetual uncertainty and failure. The brain is the seat of memory, and memory is a tricky thing. At base level, memories are stories, and sometimes these stories we tell allow us to carry on. Sometimes stories are the best we can hope for. They help us to simply get by, while deeper levels of our consciousness slap bandages on wounds that hold the power to wreck us. So we tell ourselves that the people we love closed their eyes and slipped painlessly away from us, that our personal failures are the product of external forces rather than unfixable weaknesses, that we were too damn good for the rat-ass bastards who jilted us anyway. Tell yourself these stories long enough, and you will discover they have a magical way of becoming facts. But a secret can be hidden from everyone save its holder, and the brain is not only a storyteller. It is a truth-seeking organ. If the stories we tell are no more than an overlay, the equivalent of 6 feet of caliche covering a pool of toxic sludge, something's bound to bubble up, right? And the most awful truths will do so in the darkest hours of night, when we're most vulnerable. If you bury those secrets so deep that you forget they ever happened, okay, maybe you've beat the devil. But the truth is a bloodhound. That's something I can tell you with certainty. The truth is that abandoned dog following you over sea and land, baying from barren cliff tops, never tiring and never quitting, forever pining after you. And the day will come when that dog is on your porch, scratching insistently at your door, forcing you to claim it once again. As a boy, I believed in monsters. I was convinced that if I said Bloody Mary in front of a mirror, a hideous witch woman would reach through the glass with nails sharp as splinters. I considered it a fact that the devil lingered at shadowy crossroads and went to dance halls in disguise, where he'd ask the prettiest girl to dance and reel her across the floor while spectators stood, terror-stricken at the sight of the devil's goatish shanks, until the girl fainted dead away and the unclean one vanished in a puff of brimstone. There was no falsehood I wouldn't swallow, no quilt of lies you couldn't drape over my all-too-gullible shoulders. But for a boy like me, chubby, freckled, awkward, growing up in a city where the erection of a new Kmart occasioned our mayor to announce, "This marks a wondrous new chapter in our town's history," imagination was my greatest asset, not to mention my defense against a foe worse than the most fearsome monster, loneliness. My ally against that foe was my Uncle Calvin. If I told him there was a bottomless pit in my basement, he'd say, "Tell me, Jake, is the air denser around the mouth of the pit than in other areas of the basement?" Cocking an eyebrow, "Do ominous growling sounds emanate from this pit of yours?" Uncle C was the ideal nursemaid for my paranoid fantasies. His knowledge of urban legends and folklore was encyclopedic, with the added bonus that he seemed to consider most of it true. "Hey," he'd say, "did you know there are crocodiles living in the sewers of our fair city? The poor suckers get smuggled up from Florida by dumb tourists. Sure, they're cute as a bug's ear when they're 6 inches long, but when they grow up and get nippy, bosh, down the porcelain mistake eraser. They get fat and sassy down there in the pipes, where there's plenty to eat if you're not choosy. Every year, a couple of sanitation department workers get gobbled up by sewer crocs. The press bottles it up, unscrupulous snakes that they are, but it's a fact you can set your watch to." Uncle C would fiddle with the beads of his bracelet, each an ornate pewter Kalulhu head, mouths and eye sockets sprouting tentacles, and offer a wistful sigh. "And that, Jake, is why owning a pet is a big responsibility." Once, when I was 6 or 7, I became convinced a monster lived in my closet. I told my dad, who did what 99% of adults do when their child makes this claim. He flung my closet door open, rattled coat hangers, and shoved shoeboxes aside, making a Broadway production of it. "See? No monsters, Jake." But monsters make themselves scarce when adults are around, only to slither back after dark. Every kid knew this to be an unshakable fact. Uncle C arrived for dinner that night, as usual. Mom invited him every Sunday. He got an inkling of my worry as I sat picking at my Salisbury steak. "What's the matter, hombre?" "We have an unwanted visitor in a closet, apparently," Mom informed him.
"But we've established that there's no monster," my father said. "Right, buddy?"
"Ah," said Uncle C. "I have some expertise in this area, Sam, with your permission." Mom turned to my father and said, "Sam," in the tone of voice you'd use to calm a jittery horse.
"Of course, Cal, as you like," my father said.
My uncle pedaled home to his house, returning 10 minutes later with the toolbox. Once we were in my bedroom, he motioned to the closet.
"I take it this is its lair?"
I nodded.
"Closets are a favorite haunt of monsters," my uncle explained. "Most are harmless, even good-tempered, if they have enough dust bunnies and cobwebs to eat. Do you clean your closet?"
I assured him that it was hardly ever tidied unless my mother forced the chore on me.
"Good. Let them feast. If they get too hungry, they'll crawl over to your clothes hamper and eat holes in your underwear. No need to check the seat of your drawers for confirmation, as I can see by your expression that yours have indeed met this cruel fate."
Calvin cracked the toolbox and pulled out an instrument,
one that today I'd recognize as a stud finder.
"It's a monster tracer," he said, running it over the closet walls,
making exploratory taps with his knuckles.
"There are token traces of ectoplasm," he said in the voice of a veteran.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.